Let's go down.
Pardon? Oh, yes.
Oh.
I have to confess that I feel really unworthy to be standing in this room. But it was an honor to be here with Dr. Heiser, who's done a really excellent teaching on why we baptize. And so I've asked him to say a few words about what this means and why we do it.
Chapter, so pay attention, and you're going to wonder why in the world we do this. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the Spirit, in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison, because they formerly did not obey, when God's patience waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were brought safely through water. Baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God with angels, authorities, and powers, having been subjected to him. The obvious question here is, what in the world is Peter thinking? Because he combines baptism, the resurrection, the subjugation of the angels, authorities, and powers to Jesus, the spirits being visited in prison by Jesus, Noah, and the ark. What in the world is he thinking? Well, it's an odd passage, but honestly, I don't think it's that complicated. If you can grasp one pretty profound concept, and that is typology. It's a term we've probably all heard. A type is a non-verbal prophecy. You know, we're all used to the idea of verbal prophecy. A prophet says something about the future, and then you wait for it to come to pass. A type is a non-verbal prophecy. That is an event, an institution, a person that in the Old Testament is there as part of the story arc, but that prefigures or foreshadows something yet to come. So it's a non-verbal prophecy. Now the one that's the most obvious that we know in the New Testament is Paul. Paul says in Romans 5 that Jesus was a type, a tupos of things to come. I mean, Adam was a type of Jesus. Jesus is the second Adam. So there were things about Adam that paralleled, of course, Israel, but that ultimately paralleled Jesus. So Adam is the type. Jesus is what scholars call the antitype, the fulfillment. If you can get that idea that Adam prefigured Jesus, then you can understand what's going on in 1 Peter 3, because as Adam was a type for Paul about Jesus, so Enoch was a type about Jesus for Peter. Now, what I just read to you about the spirits descending, Jesus descending and proclaiming the spirits and all that, Peter, 2 Peter has something else about that. If you knew, as many New Testament writers do, as many New Testament people do, if you knew the story of Enoch in the book of Enoch, this would make perfect sense to you. Here's the story, the quick version. The watchers descend to Mount Hermon. They take an oath among themselves to corrupt humanity. They go and they do what they're doing to corrupt humanity, and basically they get caught. They get reported. And God sentences them to doom. He sends archangels to judge them. And they're in prison. The spirit's in prison. And they get in touch with Enoch, because Enoch is in the spiritual plane. Enoch walks with God and all that. And they say, could you, as one favorite of God, could you go to God on our behalf and ask him to let us out of here? Tell him we're sorry, we made a mistake, we want out, we want forgiveness. And Enoch says, sure, I'll do that. And Enoch goes and asks God, can you relent? Can you let them out of the abyss? when God says, let me think about it. No. In other words, you're toast. You're condemned. So Enoch descended to the spirits and told them what God, his decision was. No. You're imprisoned here. You are divorced from God. You're separated from God. And that's pretty much the end of the story. So what's Peter thinking? Well, Peter is saying, well, just as Enoch did this and announced the doom of the watchers to the watchers, so Jesus descends, and his message for the spirits in prison as a the fulfillment of the foreshadowing of Enoch is essentially the same. He goes down there and says, hey guys, I bet you didn't expect to see me here because I'm dead. You probably think you won. Well, I got news for you. I'm going to be out of here in a few days, and you're still going to be here. You lose. And when Peter connects baptism to this, baptism united to Christ, he joined to Christ in his body, his death, burial, and resurrection. Every baptism is a repeated declaration to the forces of darkness that you lose. That we have chosen sides and you lose. You have no control, no condemnation over us. You're going to be here forever and we're not. So it's a repetition. So baptism, we're used to thinking about that, and it is a public declaration to other people, but it is also a public declaration to us.
Amen.
I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Down the river.
No floating.
Yeah.
Good suggestion. You're going to be facing this way, so you're going to be facing this way. Bonnie Olinger, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you. Linda, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. There are fish here that are kissing our feet.
I love it.
Nancy, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Well, since I can't see the bottom here, I'm not really used to that.
Congratulations. No, Derek. Derek, no.
So Missy's coming.
I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
All you do, she's long right there.
Derek, can we, it's too easy to lose your footing and go floating.
So she'll be at my
Yeah, very good.
Arlene, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Missy, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Joe, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
This makes me cry. Look at you. Thank you. Oh, thank you so much.
You know how to do it, yes.
All right. David, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Philip, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you. Mark, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
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 Any more help?
No, I'm good. They just want video. Thank you so much, Tom.
Lori, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, we have a special request. As husband baptized wife.
Oh, I love that.
Dr. Heiser said, once again, a public proclamation of the powers of darkness.
You both, yeah.
He wins! You lose!